Hello all, on the bench today we have yet another Yaesu FT101. This is an E model, and the guy that owned this said that over time he noticed that output was decreasing, and then it finally got where it would hardly put out any power whatsoever, and he just couldn't get the rig to tune up like it was supposed to. So he put the thing aside and haven't used it in about a year and a half or so. So it's been sitting up quite a while. Now the radio doesn't look too bad. Yeah, it's got some battle scars and stuff on it, but interesting, it still has the plastic on the front of the panel. You can see up here around the mic connector where it's kind of wrinkled and got a little bit of dirt behind it, but yeah, it still has the original plastic on it. So what we want to do is find out why the transmitter has lost its output power and see what we need to do to get it back up and running. So I'm gonna go ahead and start by removing the whole complete outside case, top and bottom, and the reason for this is that we need to get inside the PA compartment to inspect some components, and we need to get underneath of it to inspect some components. There is some components that could be failing to cause no output. You know, most of the time it could be the tubes, but there's other reasons why the tubes could fail. So we'll get in here and we'll take a good look at it and see what we can find. Okay, so got all the covers and shields off of this 101. And when I turned around and looked at the PA compartment, it was something that caught my eye right to start with. I don't know if this caused a problem or not, but just perhaps it may be the problem that has helped in the failure of the amplifier. And maybe you can see it right to start with. If you take a look at the two tubes, you can see the one on the front has the green stripe around the bottom, which means this is an original Toshiba or NEC Japanese tube. And the one next to it does not have the green stripe. You can also notice that the plate caps are different. Also, if you look at the construction inside the tube, you can see they're both different and doesn't match. So, you know, that's one of the first signs that I look at whenever we have output failure problems. Okay, I pulled those two tubes out and went ahead and checked them on the tube tester. And they both are bad. Again, the one with the green stripe, there's not a lot of writing that I can see on it, but I can barely see here 6JS6, and I can almost see the logo for Toshiba. So this is the original type of tube that was in use in this rig when it first left the factory. Now the tube next to it, first thing you see is USA. It's a 6JS6C, and it's General Electric. Now one of the things that I see on this tube, if you look right around the ghetto spots here, you can see it's turned brown around both of them, and that's usually an indication that there has been a problem in the tube. If we look in here on this side, you can see from this grid shield inside, it's black around here, which indicates this tube has been overheated. Now, if the tube was white in color, that would represent a gassy tube. But this one does not show no signs of being gassy. And just to show you what I'm talking about, I always save older tubes sometimes for showing people different things. This is an original Toshiba tube, and no, it wasn't broken in the radio. It actually fell off one of the shelves and hit the floor and cracked it, but you can see how white it is, and that was in the radio. It was removed from what is, had turned white, and basically what it is just a gassy, very gassy tube. And there's probably a crack around a pin or maybe the plate cap that could have caused that. When I first took it out, I did not see any cracks in the tube at all. But yeah, that's what a very gassy tube would look like. See that white powdery substance inside. So while we're in here, you know, you want to start checking other things. Make sure your tube base looks okay. Make sure your RF choke doesn't have any burn spots or anything on it. Look at the capacitors around. This is C125 that actually goes to the neutralization capacitor. And there's been a lot of controversy over the years about changing from Japanese tubes to American-made tubes, about getting the neutralization to work right. There was a note from Yaesu back many years ago that went out to text saying that if you change from the Japanese tube, this is a 100 picofarad capacitor, that you need to change this to a 10 picofarad capacitor. Because, you know, in your tube you got feedback, and then you got unwanted feedback, and neutralization cancels out feedback and inductance that forces the tube, you know, with that, when it's out of phase, will go into oscillation. And you'll turn your rig on, if it's not set right, you'll see the plates in the tube actually start turning red. And that's because the tube has gone into oscillation, and a lot of times you can hear it in the receiver. And it can also, you know, take your receive right down to nothing where you can't hear anything because it just gets so noisy in here. So, you know, that's why we have to neutralize output tubes in these older type of rigs. A lot of rigs on the market has to have the output tubes neutralized. So again, you know, you're canceling out that capacitance and inductance. As you've seen from the first two tubes I just showed, which are built entirely different from one another. Either, I mean, looking inside of it, it's just completely different. The capacitance in these tubes are going to be nowhere near a match, and it would be no way to neutralize those two tubes and get it to stop from going into self-oscillation. So everything in here looks good. I'll have to measure this cap and see just what it is. If it is the original 100 picofarad or if it's been changed, I do not know. I'm just going to get here and measure this capacitor and see just what we have. And we're showing at 0.113 nanofarads. You know, 0.1 nanofarad is equal to 100 picofarads. So that is a 100 picofarad original capacitor in there. Now, I'm not going to change it. I'm going to put USA made tubes back in it, and we'll check it and see if we can't get the neutralization to minimize in this rig, then we'll have to go back and change this. I'll be honest with you, over the years, I have never really had a big problem. I think that was one rig I did change it to a 10 picofarad. Now the range of the neutralization capacitor down here is not that great. It's only like 10 picofarad. Okay, we're looking under the bottom side. We want to just check things out down here and you know, make sure everything looks okay, and then we'll do some testing on a couple of components just to make sure. And I should have went ahead and removed this, but I didn't. You want to remove this trimmer board here and have a look underneath of it and see if there's any crispy critters. I don't mean bugs, I'm talking about components. And just from a general inspection, you know, it's looking pretty good. I'm not seeing anything that's out of the ordinary. Let me move the camera. Okay, now we can get a better picture. We look here under the tube sockets. We can see our current shunt resistor here, and it looks all right. You know, I thought it was kind of burnt to start with, but it's not. It's just that the fabric covered wire has just gotten dirty over the years. It looks okay. I see our 100 ohm resistor here is intact. Grid resistors are looking good. A 5 watt and 7 watt resistor looks okay, not burnt up. And there's C13 tucked away under here, which is a molded mica cap. Now this should be replaced regardless if it's good or bad, because these old silver molded caps are notorious for shorting, and when it does, you know, it's going to cause all kinds of nasty problems down underneath. So we'll have to get this changed out to a 80 picofarad 1.5 to 2 kilovolt cap, just to protect our final circuit. There's something I've noticed in a lot of these rigs that I work on is, let me zoom in just a little bit closer, but not so close that we go out of focus. If you look here by this last set of bands wafers on the band switch, I always see this brown wire has been cut. It definitely has to be a factory modification. I just don't know why they would cut that brown wire, because about everyone ever seen that brown wire has been cut. Yeah, I think there's been only one or maybe two rigs I ever seen where this brown wire was not cut. You know, on TV you always cut the red wire, but and these things, they always cut the brown wire. No idea why. So before we do any other further, you know, we checked everything under the tubes and made sure that all the components were okay, and so nothing that was overheated or anything that was out of tolerance. We'll look at this regulator board, and this is PB1547. And if you look from pin 5 back over towards pin 1, ignore everything on this side of the screen. This section right here controls our bias voltage to our final tubes. We have a minus 100 volts or plus depending on your line current coming in on pin 5, and it comes up here through some resistors with some filtering, and it'll come over here to VR1, which is your bias control part. That then takes that 100 volts and you pick off of it, and it'll come down to pin 2, which goes to your final tube for biasing, and it should be somewhere around negative 60 volts. Now, another thing that a lot of people overlook and do not even consider thinking about is your power tube, and it's very important that you get the correct bias voltage on your driver tube. Now, it's not adjustable in this circuit. Again, you can see the driver tube, it comes down through these from the same line. Before you get to VR1, you'll go through a resistor, which is R7, and you'll see a diode down here, and there's another resistor. Then it goes through a R9, and it'll come down to pin 4, and this voltage needs to be somewhere around minus 20 volts, and that puts the correct bias on your driver tube. And you know, if you got one that's had problems in the with oscillating or any kind of bias issue, always make sure you check pin 4 of your regulator. And this goes down to pin 2 of your driver tube, and make sure that you have the correct voltage there. And it should be somewhere around minus 20 volts. So I have the radio sitting on its tube side again, with the back of it to my left, and you can see the connector for your regulator unit. And I'm gonna go ahead and apply voltage now. And when you're doing this, you know, you have to be real careful, because there's a lot of high voltage in this rig. So if you're doing so, you're doing it at your own risk. Just be careful. All right, the radio is on. We'll go to pin 2. And we have minus 64 volts. And we're going over to pin 4, which is going to supply bias to our driver tube. And we have minus 20.7 volts. So we're looking pretty good on our bias. We know our bias is there. Now, without bias, these tubes are going to run away and just burn up before you can even get it tuned up. So it's always good to check pin 2 and pin 5. Pin 4 on this regulator unit to make sure. Now, again, your bias comes in on pin 5. Okay, I now have all the covers back on the final compartment, and what we've done, we put the radio, we turned it on, we got the heaters on. We put it in the tune position. I'm on band C on 0. This is 29 megahertz. And what we're going to do is just what I call a quick and dirty tune up. And all I'm going to do is just flip the mark switch and peak all the controls just for maximum RF out. And the reason why we do this, you know, our bias is not set correctly, and we don't want to overheat our tubes by just flipping the mark switch, peaking the pre-select, the loading, and the plate. We'll get it somewhere close to resonance, and we don't have to worry about turning our tubes red and burning them up before we can get started. So I'll go ahead and do that off camera. Just, you know, just go through it, just peek them out. Only a couple of seconds per control this way. You're not putting that much heat in there. And what we do, we want it completely tuned up on 29 megahertz. Then we can check our neutralization. Now our neutralization capacitor, which is a variable capacitor, TC27, is located right in here. Let's see if I can zoom in on that just a little bit. There, you can see it sticking up right there. It's a little shaft. Let me tell you, be careful when you're tuning. Make sure you're using something that is insulated. There is high voltage on this shaft, and if you stick a screwdriver in there and you're touching it, you're gonna get a nasty zap. So just be careful with doing that. Now what we're gonna do is called a cold neutralization, and again, I do this, and I'd rather do a cold neutralization instead of doing it the way that the manual tells you to. You put less stress on your tubes by doing it this way. And to do a cold neutralization, all we're going to do is come to the back of the rig and pull this plug out of the accessory socket. Disconnect our dummy load. And what we're going to do is put a connector that's going to our oscilloscope. We have a T with a 50 ohm 5 watt resistor on the other end terminating it. And you need to make sure you're using at least a couple of watts, because we're still getting about a watt of power out of this unit with this accessory jack unplugged, and all this does is turning the heaters off. Okay, shot of the scope there. We got the radio in tune, it's turned on. I don't see no filaments glowing in the PA section, which is good, but we definitely don't want no 100 watts going into our scope. So we're going to flip the mock switch. Oh boy, see, we got full screen, advanced the volts per division. Okay, that's more manageable. I'm going to go ahead and get my tuning tool, and I'm just using a tool here. It has a metal tip. It's about 3/8 inch in the length, and it's in a plastic holder. And I have made these tools before using plastic rods and cutting a small piece of metal and heating it up and just sliding it into the end of it. Like I say, you do not want to be touching this capacitor with any metal. We're going to flip the mock switch and immediately start adjusting. There's the scope. Down to its lowest setting. And that looks pretty good. I see no need of replacing that 100 picofarad capacitor. So I noticed we have a little issue with our meter switch in the IP position. It's working in the ALC and power out, but in IC position it doesn't work, not unless you press on the switch. Now I tried spraying some cleaner in it and using some deoxit, and it still hasn't cleared it up. So I think what we're going to have to do is remove this switch and have a peek at it. So the easiest way to get to this is go ahead and remove these boards out, and we'll simply join that by unbolting the shields and just pulling the boards right out. Instead of undoing all the screws and taking the boards apart, they'll come out fairly easy. Okay, I got all the boards poured out of the way, and that's a good time to get in there and just do a little cleaning while we're in there. But you know, we now can get to the two screws that hold the switch in. Okay, I've got the switch unbolted from the chassis, and since cleaning it did not do any good, I took the handle off also. What we're going to have to do is bend these four little tangs up and slide this switch apart so we can actually get to the contacts. Now, you know, if it's a newer model radio, you just simply order a new one. But even if you got a used one off of eBay or something, it could have the same problem. So we're going to have to see if we can fix this one. And when you take this apart, be very careful, because there's some little clips here in the back, and there's going to be some little metal contacts, and all that can just fall out and disappear. Now, you know, instead of having to take the time to desolder all these wires off and to get the switch out, we're just going to work on it right here in the radio. And what I've done was took a paper towel and tore the edge and just got it all up here. This way, if any parts fall out of the switch, it'll fall down in here and they won't be thrown into the abyss. We should be able to find them if we're lucky. Alright, so there it is, and you can see that the body of the switch has been removed from this little circuit board material. And I can't get that close up with the camera, but I can see that the switch is just completely tarnished. So having a look here under the microscope, you can see that the contacts that are mounted into the board are just completely tarnished black. This is never going to make too good of a connection like that. So what I have to do is just pull these little spring clips off. These move back and forth by the handle mechanism to select two pads on each one for the three positions. So we have to take these off, and we'll have to clean all these terminals and then clean these little spring clips. So to clean these little contact fingers, I just mounted them on a piece of cardstock. Just slip them right on. It's about the same size as the blades of the terminals. I'll hold my finger on it, and I'll spray some contact cleaner on it and move these back and forth, and that'll pretty much clean the inside out just by doing that. These will move back and forth real easy. You don't want to use no sandpaper. So by looking at our cardstock, you can see this line right across here, and that's where the contacts is white back and forth. And you keep doing that, and then just simply after you think you got it clean, you go to the other side, and you know, there's a faint line across the contact, and you keep doing that until you don't see any residue left on the cardstock. That way you know your contact is pretty clean. And you can also see now that our terminals here are completely clean, and what I cleaned this with was nothing but my vinegar and salt solution. I use a little paintbrush to paint it on, and go back with a toothbrush and scrub it off after letting it soak for about 3 or 4 minutes with that vinegar salt solution. I haven't seen that video, that's listed under video number 40, and think it's called clean and wiper switches and controls. But you can see just how nice and bright that is now. There's no more of that black tarnish on it. And we'll put a little bit of deoxit. I'll probably use some deoxit D100 ale. That'll keep it lubricated and keep it clean for years to come. Okay, our switch is all put back together. Now we can go ahead and get it reinstalled. And we should be good to go on just that little issue. You know, I want to say that it's a big difference between repairing a radio and restoring a radio. I get lots of emails where people ask me to restore a radio for them, and I don't think they understand the difference between restoring and repairing. A lot of rigs are worth restoring. In fact, anything is worth restoring. But when it comes to, I had a guy recently emailed me about an oscilloscope, wanted me to restore it, so Tektronix. And I looked it up, and it was a 5 megahertz bandwidth oscilloscope. It would be nice, yes, to have a oscilloscope like that restored. But it's not worth it in the price range, because what it costs to sit down and restore something, you're talking about going in there and, you know, cleaning the radio, taking care of cosmetic issues, checking every component, replacing everything that's bad, getting all the caps up to date. And I don't like the way this relay is sitting in here. It's at an angle, and it's not all the way pushed down. And I can see why this terminal that's down here is keeps the relay from falling out. It should be bent up in the little screw under the bottom of the relay. It's supposed to catch on to that, and that helps hold the relay in, but I'll have to take care of that now. But, you know, it's not cost-worthy for someone to restore a radio that's, or a piece of equipment of any chance, you know, for someone like me to do. Now, if you're into the hobby and you're know how to do such things, you can do it, and you're taking that labor factor out of something that could take a person 40 hours or so to sit down and restore. Yeah, that's much better. That sits in there like it's supposed to. So, yeah, you know, I get those emails all the time where people want me to restore stuff. And again, you know, I don't think that they're actually thinking about what it would cost to restore something. If you have an old piece of equipment like that, that's a good time for you to actually sit down and learn how to do it yourself. And this way you keep the labor factor out of it. But for someone like me to do it, no, it's not worth it. And I wouldn't recommend it to anyone sending in something. Not unless just has a big sentimental value on it, because if it doesn't, you're going to have more in labor than what the thing is worth to start with. And I wouldn't recommend doing that. And I get so many people asked, what kind of equipment do I need to learn how to work on radios? Well, it's not a matter of what equipment do you need. It's mostly the matter of what your level of knowledge is to work on radios. You've got to have basic understanding of electronics before you can fix radios. Now, there's no amount of test equipment on the bench that's going to help you do that. I have worked on radios for years with nothing more than a voltmeter, an old Heathkit signal generator, and a single tracer. And that was about all the equipment I had back then. And I repaired lots of units. Now, was I able to do proper alignment where you need visual needs to actually look at a waveform back then? No, I didn't. And I couldn't do those repairs. I had to limit myself. So, you know, getting that basic electronic knowledge is what you got to have to even begin to learn how to work on radios. Anyway, enough on that. We'll move on to checking out this meter now and make sure it works. Okay, I've got the radio and transmit. Got the bias set at about 60 milliamps of current. So that's looking good. Should be able to go to power out. Tune. Hit mox. Power out, tune, dip the plate, tune it out, and we got a good 100 watts on the meter. So there you go, final tube replacement in a Yaesu FT101E, and checked out everything looks good. Didn't have to do no big changes other than changing out that Mikey motor capacitor, which was C13, and like I said, we just changed that to a 80 picofarad 1.5 kilovolt silver dip capacitor. So I hope you enjoyed that. I hope it's helped someone. I've had a lot of requests to show how to change out the funnels in one of these radios, but if you stick around and in the future, there'll be lots more repairs on the FT101. We have plenty of them to go through, so we'll be showing a whole lot more and getting more in depth with it. Like I say, I've been wanting to get this series back kicked off and get it back, you know, underway, and with this I think I better make some time to get in the shop and get some things done. Anyway, if you enjoyed the video, you know, please leave your comment down below. Likes always a help. So if you would, please leave a like. And we'll catch you in the next video. See you now.